The Urim and Thummim. The Urim and Thummim. The Urim and Thummim. Lights and Perfection.
My name is Todd Walker. I have a miracle in my life called the Urim and Thummim, and I'd like to share it with you. Join in and watch with me. See what your conclusions are. The object you see before you is the Urim and Thummim. I am the discoverer and the protector of the Urim and Thummim. I take pride in that title. You know, I believe I was blessed with the object, so it is my job to protect it and maintain its safety so everybody gets a chance to experience it. You know, when people look into the object, so many of them see different things. When you look and you peer into this object that I have, you're looking at the pyramids in Egypt, and I see people walking toward the pyramids, and I can even see the dust coming from their feet. It's like I'm actually there. When I started to see the images, I already knew at that moment when my eyes was enlightened to them that I had a hard road ahead of me, brother. Well, I was born in Dearborn, Michigan, to a loving mother and a loving father. My dad was a musician. As a child, I used to go to rehearsals with my father. It was a rock and roll band. They used two drummers, and they was on break. Well, both drummers, after break, didn't come back in. So old Toddy, from just watching them at 9 years old, I got up on a set of them drums, and the next week, Toddy had a set of drums. Because my dad and his friends seen the potential of me and what I had, you know. And so from that day on, I mean, I would go in clubs with my daddy and his friends at 9 years old and 10 years old all up in Detroit. It was hard times, but my daddy and I had just a long kind of struggle with going out to Arizona and being homeless, what you would call sleeping in a van, you know, down by the river. But it was good. And so I chose to take it upon myself and go to Nashville, Tennessee. I went uptown and got a fake ID card saying I was 18. And I started playing music on Broadway, Lower Broadway, on the strip down there. And had a ball doing it. That's where I took a lot of my music school and I learned so much. I just never got the lucky break in the music business that I wanted. So I called my daddy. He had went back to Nashville, Tennessee. And he said, Todd, we need a drummer. Well, my daddy told me we was going to be playing a little three-piece gig with a fella playing guitar, myself on drums, and my daddy on bass guitar, and his daughter would be singing. Well, we came in that day to play in the old Rhinestone Cowboy. His name was Tiny Leo, my daddy-in-law. He kept telling me about how pretty the daughter was, pretty the daughter was. So here she come in, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful girl. In every way, not just looks-wise, but I mean her heart. As big as the world, it is big as the world. She's the reason I'm here today. You know, she kept me alive. What I did, I moved to Rantoul, Illinois to get out of Nashville, and I worked in a window factory there, Cradco Windows. I worked there for about 1.5 years. And I was trying the regular steady job thing, you know, but I'm here to tell you, I'm not a regular steady job guy.
When I first met him, Todd was working at a window factory up in Illinois, and that's the only job I've ever known that he's, you know, had a regular job. He worked as a musician here in Nashville and in convenience stores, and that's how his hearing got messed up. He was a clerk in a convenience store here in Nashville, and a guy come in and robbed the place. And while that guy was robbing the place, an off-duty security officer walked in. And when he seen, you know, that guy pointing a gun at Todd, he just pulled his gun, and them two went at it. And that big revolver's going off, and one went off right beside his head and messed his hearing up. So he doesn't play the drums no more, you know. You know, on a professional basis, because his hearing's messed up.
Yeah! Been too long, boys, too long.
I thought we did one called Heartaches by the Number. We could do that one, can't we?
Well, I'm David Jones, and I'm Todd's brother-in-law. And he's more like a brother to me, the best friend I've ever had, and I've been with him pretty much all along in his discovery of what we believe to be the Urim and Thummim.
My sister was going with Dave. So that's how actually I met Dave. Because he was going with my sister. Well, one day he asked me, Todd, can you do tile work? I said, well, I can labor myself hard, you know. And so that's what took me into the tile business.
I was working for a company called London Tiles, and Todd and Dale, they wasn't really doing too good up there in Owensboro, and I called them down and let them work with me. And a lot of times, you know, I just wanted to, you know, help them out. I know they needed it.
Hey, Davey, y'all ready to work?
Yeah, you ready to get that tile job done?
Dale's a good laborer. Yeah, Dale's a darn good laborer. He's not real big, but his heart's big enough. That'll take care of the rest, you know.
Dale, he's a little slow sometimes, but he's a good worker, though. He gives it his best shot, you know.
Hi, I'm Leo Dale Bloomfield. I'm Todd Walker's brother-in-law, and I'm a witness for the Urim and Thummim. It's amazing, very amazing, and it has caught me on fire 24/7.
Well, yeah, me and Todd and Dale, we're the only three that's really, you know, studied it a lot.
It's only three people that's actually seen us. It's Todd, me, and David.
There's only three of us right now, Dale, myself, and my other brother, Davey, that has took the time to look at that, to get the divine revelation.
Yeah, it's going in there. I'll get started on it right now, tear that floor up.
We had a good thing going. It's just that, you know, I got degenerative disc disease in my back, and carrying them buckets of mud up and down them stairs, man, about wore me out. I love to work. I love to sweat. I love to work. But that was just putting a toll on my back.
What a job. What a job.
The day that I was to go to Nashville to start this tile job, I picked Dale up down here at his house. And so we get into Nashville, and we're both homeboys, me and Dale. We love our family. We love to be home. You know, we love Owensboro. We love it here. So we left here and we arrived in Nashville. And we was a little bit late.
We came to Nashville and we was running a little late. And I knew my other brother-in-law, he would have been scolding me like crazy if I would have been late. And I don't like that, you know. So, I mean, he would have been getting down on me. Anyway.
My other brother was with me, so we was running real late. Then we know we might get... you know, get in trouble a little bit from Brother Dave.
He was supposed to come to work that day when he found it, and I didn't hear nothing from him. And he didn't show up at the job, and I tried calling his house. It was about 2-3 weeks before I talked to him. They never would answer the phone.
There's a long story to the story. See, to the time I left this driveway and picked Dale up over here a couple blocks over and went to Nashville, and didn't want to get scolded at for being late. Really didn't want to go to work to begin with.
Didn't even like the job.
Yeah, we don't like the tile work because it's, you know, kind of hard and hot. But anyway.
So I stopped in a thrift store.
We didn't go to work that morning. We went to a thrift store. To make a long story short, we went into Goodwill.
And I looked to my left up in Madison there, and there's a Goodwill superstore. Well, we ended up at the Madison Goodwill in Nashville, Tennessee, is where we are now. We're going to walk in here and show you where it all began.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen.
So we go in there. I was looking for old glassware. I've come to know that carnival glasses these people collect. So I'm going to look for something to buy and resell, no matter what it is, you know. That's what I do. I buy and resell. And so I'm going through there, and all of a sudden, I seen on the shelf a little object sitting up there, this little black piece of, looked like marble. And I said, well, what's that? And Dale said, it's an old piece of rock. And when I picked it up, lo and behold, it was one of the most beautiful pieces I've ever seen in my life. It was something that drawed me to it.
We only had about $15 in our pocket when we bought that thing.
How much did you pay for it?
69 cents.
They just didn't know what it was. We didn't either. He's
but,
always buying.
You know,
why'd you buy that thing?
We don't.
What is that?
When I picked it up, though, I knew it wasn't just a piece of old marble or something. It was definitely carved out in a cool way. It wasn't just a stone or a rock, you know. And when I picked it up, because it was laying face down, what I call face down, when I picked it up, Doctor, and I seen that object, I said, my Lord, that thing is old, very old. But when I picked it up, I knew it was very, very, very old, first of all. Second of all, it's got unique features. I didn't know what I had.
There was a feeling inside that drawed me to this object. Now, you got to understand, it was a miracle for me to even be in that same place with this object sitting there. We only had $15 in our pocket now to do whatever we was going to do, whether it was to go to work and make more money in Nashville or to put gas in that darn old car and get back home to Owensboro. And if and God only knows, if the piece would have been in a glass showcase up front at the store for $5, we wouldn't have bought it, brother. I wouldn't have, because I wouldn't have blown $5 out of our 15. I'm not a stingy person like that. But I, you know, so I took it up there in the glass where they said everything was 69 cents.
Well, later on that evening, Doc, because this sat in the Goodwill bag on my kitchen table all that day. Dale, I dropped off back at home. He was living with his girlfriend then. So I looked. That's when I picked the object up. I said, Tanita, hand me the magnifying glass. I just got to see what color this is. Mm-hmm. And I started to see what color it was, Doctor. And all of a sudden, I looked for about 2 hours. Something kept telling me to look. I can't explain it. Something kept telling me to look for a reason. And Doctor, when I hit it in the light just right, the way this work is done, the light beam has to come in at a certain way. And when it does, it will be revealed to you like that.
And when I hit that thing just right in the light, the most ancient, awesome images was revealed to my eyes. Like you never ever imagined them.
You know, Dale and my wife was sitting on the couch and they started laughing at me again. And it really started hurting me then, you know. That'd be like if I was crippled and you're going to laugh at me. You don't laugh at anybody anyway, no matter what, as far as I'm concerned. Mm-hmm. We're all here. We're all equal, you know. But I got very highly mad, and I said, look here, you can laugh. You can laugh all you want. I said, but you need to go outside and laugh. Don't laugh in my face. I said, as a matter of fact, Dale, you're going to come here, and you're going to look one more time before you even go outside to laugh. Come here. And it was a serious moment. And when I showed this man here, and when he started to see, Doctor, you know, that confirmed to me right there.
I was looking inside of it, and I seen this, what sounds crazy, it's like a castle, I would say, or a cave, or a castle, I would say. Very first time I looked into it was with a bright light. And I was inside of this castle, and I had this demon, this thing, chasing me. And I was trying to get away from it, and I got turned around, coming around the block of it, you know, like coming through, going down some stairs. This thing was hiding behind the stairs or something, and jumped out and chased me. That sounds crazy. And as I come down the stairs, there's this thing that jumps out to chase me. I don't know how to explain it, except it looked like it was part pig body and part evil bat face, and it chased me. And what really brought me to reality is when I come across, when I was trying to get back up to the top of the staircase to get away from this thing that was scaring the fire out of me. God popped up, man, and held his hand like this, and it just fell apart. It just all crumbled. Whatever was chasing me just more or less just fell apart. And God appeared. This thing fell apart.
It's ancient or small micro size images that are so perfect in detail, and a lot of them look like they illuminate at you. And when you turn the object, what once was one image, it'll be another image perfect to that image, and you won't be able to tell where the other image was even on there.
First time that I ever seen it, my first impression was that it was a map, an ancient map of the universe, the stars and the planets and all the things like that. And he showed me the little carvings on it, the little minute carvings. And that was pretty amazing, because I know that no human hand could have made them.
When I seen this, let's just put it to you this way. I was knocked down like the spirit would take the soul of a punch and knock you out. I was floored. I was flabbergasted. When I get to talking about it, I get on fire.
I mean, it's just like watching CNN on TV. I mean, the things you see. I've stood there and watched helicopters fly over my head, and I mean, it was like I was inside of it. And just rockets and missiles going off all over. It looked like to me like I was getting the impression the whole world was attacking Israel. And then I seen two big blasts, two big, looked like nuclear explosions going off there in the Middle East.
Seen armies marching, planes flying, everything.
It's all that in a bag of chips, man. Yeah.
As I was looking into it, the ground burst like lava, okay? You had Hell's angels on one side, and you had Satan's angels on the other side, like the rapture had happened, brother. And they are fighting. Satan's angels are fighting to save. The demons are snatching souls up to try to throw them, and these angels are catching them. A Satan himself in a lake of fire sitting back there, and he's got a gold coin in the tip of his mouth like that. He's laying back like that, just smiling like that, and his horns are back there, and he's just laying back there trying to play hide, you know, back there. And I'm not kidding you. He's laying there like it's a bathtub of water in his fire and brimstone, brother. I don't know any other way to tell you.
And you can look in, it's just like you're looking at a television set, moving pictures in color. You just move the light, just keep moving the light. It's like you're changing the channel. You can see another person, another person, another person. You can see images of ancient times and images of modern times too.
I've been in different lands. I've been in somewhere where there's columns and pillars that are maybe 6, 8, 10 feet round that are just crumpled to the ground, and I'm just looking in there, and I'm just standing there, and I could just feel that I could reach out and touch.
But I think it might take different people to different time zones.
There's a guard on each side of that. This guy over here has got a big long sword, and this one over here has got like a shepherd's staff.
They're like guarding.
You can see them with the naked eye.
This gate right here. What I looked at last night when I started looking at this was a guy that was guarding that all the way back. As far as I could see, it was people behind him. And it was the most amazing thing, like they were all coming this way toward that gate.
Been times I've been looking at it, and I was looking down on my own house. It's like, you know, you're flying over the world, you know, real slow, and just looking down. I've seen modern cities, I've seen airplanes taking off from airports, seen all kinds of amazing things.
There's everything from angels flying in there to people screaming help me.
But then there's windows up here that you can look in, and you can see people are screaming. You can tell they're in pain, and they're screaming.
Why they're there? Maybe it's for their judgment. Maybe it's time for them to be judged. Who knows? Who knows? But I tell you, I tell you one thing, I would not want to be there.
It's hard to talk about. You have to see it to believe it. That's for sure. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people think we're crazy, but I don't really care what anybody thinks, you know. I know what I believe and what I've seen, and I'll believe it till the day I die.
Sounds too good to be true, and you might think, well, these guys are just crazy, you know. But you really got to look to get the real divine revelation of it. And if you ever do, you'll be blown away, dude.
It's the Urim and Thummim, man. I believe it, and it comes from right here. The day I walked in here, it changed my life. We've been on a long venture, it seems like.
I can't deny the things that I've seen. Totally cool pictures. I see faces. I see things that are very detailed. It's like a never-ending wall of faces. I'm talking side profiles, the whole nine yards. I mean, and you can see so much. I mean, just depending on the time that you choose to give looking into it. I mean, and I thought Todd was nuts. I really did.
I actually thought he lost his mind. But then he got me to look into it. Then I thought I lost my mind.
tell folks a little bit about it, Matt.
There's a head in the bottom. It looks like a side profile of Jesus. And he has a dictionary, a Wycliffe dictionary in there, and the Bible that tells, like, it has the picture of the same guy that's in it. So, and on the back, there's like a king's head with like a hummingbird stuck in the sap of his head. I've seen that.
I don't think Todd's crazy. I don't think that Todd is making anything up. I really think that anybody that gives the time deserved in looking at this thing is going to see that the longer you look at it, the more time that you give looking into this, the more things that you're going to see. And that's just there.
I got to thinking about how I needed a perfect light to look down in the object with. So the light that I come up with is a simple one. It's a little LED light that I have that I buy at your local radio store. That's the light that I use. Simple. And as I begin to look at the images on the object, some of them were so small that I had to figure out a way to make them clearer so we could see them, because I really wanted to see exactly what I was looking at. So I come up with an idea that my dad had mentioned by looking down in it with a simple jeweler's eye. I had to even get smaller than the jeweler's eye. I was trying to look at it, just each individual image just by itself, and took the peripheral vision out so I could just specifically concentrate on the one little image that I was looking down in. And what I came up after that was another simple solution, which I come up with the thing the old ear doctor uses to look in your ears with. It's a very little tiny tip, but what it does when I put this tip on this jeweler's eye and I put black tape around the edges, it takes out all the peripheral vision. And so when you look down into the Urim and Thummim with this right here, all you're gonna see is what you're pointing this little tip at down in there. And it brings it up so clear that it'll blow your mind, for real.
With a magnifying glass, without it, I have seen things. I have seen images. I have seen what I believe to be the shape form of an angel with wings. I have seen many faces. And on the outer edge of this, the top part, the flat part, you can make out faces. A lot of side profiles of men with hats, with beards, very detailed in the eyes, in the face, and the mustaches and things. So, I mean, I've seen my share, enough to where I believe.
I was in the insurance company the other day. These girls asked me, she said, "What's your occupation?" I said, "Archaeologist." You know, I said, "Side-time tile setter."
I believe it.
And, you know, I meant that. I mean, it sounds crazy, but as far as I'm concerned, what I have is an archaeological find of a lifetime. I believe I can be considered an archaeologist for my discovery that I've made right now. I love everybody so much, I want to tell them about it. So I seen Jerry Burge on TV. He's a local television man on Channel 8. And so I called Jerry Burge and I told him the story. And he said, "Well, bring it over to my house." He said, "But if you'll wait till about 7 o'clock, my wife would like to look at it too. I want her here." So Dale and I brought it over to their house. You know, at this time, I didn't know that his wife had been a two-time grand champion on the TV show Jeopardy. You know, you're talking about not somebody that's only smart in mathematics or auto building or something. Somebody that's got pretty good sense all the way across the board, you know. And these are the people that I want you people to listen to. Don't listen to me. Can I get a witness?
Can I get a witness? Todd came to me with an interest in possibly going on our local television show here on cable to explain this rather unique object that he found in a shop in Nashville. While he was here, we took a look. We used our digital camera. We looked into the vessel, as I like to call it, and we saw some strange things indeed. When you first saw it, what did you think?
There are definitely scenes carved into this thing. That's what I saw in it.
I think if you look real close, you can see what appears to be some religious.
They could almost be biblical, yeah. Or some kind of, they look like something from antiquity.
But you can actually start to see them faces, mm-hmm. The side profiles of different, of the pharaohs or the silver rulers from way back in them biblical days.
It's possible to do very minute carving. And I really do think there are actual scenes. I mean, I see what looks like people.
But you got to understand, MAGA, all the other people that went and let me come, and then y'all did, and then for y'all's eyes to be open to the things, that was a miracle to me.
Well, his sincerity does impress you. I mean, he's convinced that there really is something to this, and I can't say that he's not right.
We were very skeptical, but after he came here, and we took the pictures, yeah. And we used the little jeweler's tool, and we could see inside. We really, when you left, we sat here and said, you know, he's got something there. I really think he does. What it is, I don't know. Can I get a
witness? She is Jeopardy smart, and Jerry, her husband, he's a local television man. He's another well-to-do person, you know, a prominent figure in our community. Kathy at the AutoZone, you know, she's a prominent figure in our community. Kathy Devin's house. Let's see if we can get her to the door and let her tell us a little bit about this artifact. She was tripped out when she seen it, you know.
Kathy's the manager of a fine auto parts business.
pretty well known, I'd say, in the United States. So this is a prominent figure we're talking to here, folks. This ain't just another one of my crazy friends. This lady is a well-respected lady in our community.
Thank you. I think it's maybe some type of a religious urn of some type. It's something beyond what anybody on earth has done, I think.
What I do, hon, is hold this thing like, put these two fingers on there. Okay. I hold the light over the holes with that. And okay. If you'll direct the light when you look inside right toward one little spot in the bottom,
mm-hmm.
and hold it perfectly still, and take that jeweler's eye, okay. and put that up to your eye, and try to start looking.
Oh, my hands are shaking also, and it's hard to get it to hold still. This is wicked. What is this thing leaping out at me?
It'll be real 3D, Kathy.
Oh.
I believe everything from the outside to the inside of this is there for a reason. All the images, I believe, connect together to form one story. Mm-hmm. I believe it could actually be maybe the visual text of the Bible itself, is what I believe. It's all 3D right there. See
there's
that?
There's just something, yeah, there's something uh-huh. jumping out of that.
Uh-huh. It's just all like it's 3D, isn't
coming
it?
Coming at you.
Yeah.
Nothing would surprise me.
But
that's for sure.
It is. It's something. It's something that I believe the human race ain't seen in thousands of years. It was so secretive back in the biblical times, man. All they had was brief descriptions of it, what it was, maybe what it wasn't. You know, they've got them so mixed up. But this is the Urim and Thummim.
She's some kind of wonderful. Some kind of wonderful, yes she is.
I don't know if that's it or not. Let me see here.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Tim Case Beer. I met Tim because he used to write Jesus Saves on his car. He has no shame about putting Jesus Saves on his car and driving around town for weeks at a time.
Yeah, it's y'all's loss. If y'all don't believe in the Urim and Thummim, here it is right here in my hands. And I've seen many things in it, and it's a real true thing. And I swear to God, you know, that I'm not lying. This is from God, and I believe it from my heart. And it's opened my eyes even more. And I believe in Jesus Christ and always have. But this has even opened my eyes even more because I have seen things in there that blew my mind. I really have. It shows in the Urim and Thummim where God was angry with Adam and Eve. And they are hiding behind the bushes like they was scared looking up. I seen that, and I swear to God on it. And God is my witness, and that's what I seen in there. I'm not making it up or anything. But I seen the devil and the pitchforks, and I seen kings and riding horses. And I seen this Iraqi guy like over there in... Saudi Arabia? Was it Saudi Arabia or was it?
Saddam
Hussein. That's what I was trying to say.
Can I get a witness?
We'll go down here and see old one of my good friends, Bobby Wilson. He used to be a professional wrestler. When I first showed him the Urim and Thummim, I mean, it was like I tried to hand him the magnifying glass, and he said, I don't even need that magnifying glass.
When I looked in, I seen mountains. I seen eagles, I seen angels, I swear, I seen Jesus Christ a couple times.
That's right.
And stuff, and I seen kings in there, you know, and stuff, and I said, this is wild. And matter of fact, you had that eyeglass, and I was looking at it with the light on top of my head.
Right,
my
yeah, you didn't even
And
look.
I said, I didn't need that. I said, well, I can see it right here. You
That's
know,
right.
And I said, I mean, it's wild. I said, you got you something here, brother. I said, you know, and then I hold it back and look at it, I seen just like little marks on it. I said, looks like scratches, but I mean, when you look at it, actually look dead at it, you can see it.
Uh-huh.
You know, but it's like God says, though, he said, you come to me with an open mind and open heart, and I will feed you.
Yeah, I did. I thought they were crazy. Todd said, here, I want you to look at this. He brought a magnifying glass and a light, and I saw Todd, there's nothing in there. Well, then him and his brother, they got to turn it around and twist it around, and I was like, hey, I see a horse. Oh, there's an angel. There's a cross. There's all kinds of stuff there. Y'all are in for a treat. I'm telling you, a real treat. And every time I see Todd, I say, Todd, did you do anything with that thing that you have? And he says, not yet, but I'm going to. So the world needs to open their eyes, because that was given to Todd for some reason. Why, I don't know. But Todd found it in a junk store for just some odd reason. And Todd was probably the only one that would have thought to look inside. And Todd's probably the only one that that probably could take all the criticism of people saying that he was crazy and that he was losing his mind. He about did lose his mind to try to figure out what was inside. So you're in for a treat. That's the only thing I can tell you.
Because, I mean, you can look into it and you can see God's creation, and that's what it is.
Right.
You know, and stuff. And there's a whole storyline there if people were smart enough to figure it out. But I'm not smart enough to figure it out.
Well,
you know,
we're on the road to it. That's what we're doing here. We want to put, you know, let everybody see that we're not just making these images.
No,
up.
I mean, you can look at yourself. But that goes back to anything when you look at it, though. You got to go with an open heart and open mind for Jesus. I mean, when you look at it, you don't really have to, but if you go with that image, you'll see more in there.
Follow me to Tennessee.
Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness?
I get my thrill off of showing other people. I pray as they're looking into it in my own self, in my own heart, that God, please open their eyes. Let them get this divine revelation.
Like I say, I got no priest that wouldn't even let me come to the church to show them this object for a minute. When I told them, they automatically judged me as maybe being a crazy or a nutso. But, you know, everyday ordinary people, now they stick around and they'll give me their time.
The Urim and Thummim, it just makes me think. And ever since I saw it, man, I've had these, you know, how you get the hairs stand up on the back of your neck. That's what it felt like when I first looked into it. It's kind of weird. But other than that, man, I just don't know what to think about it. I'm not here, you know, talking about God and Jesus and all that stuff. I mean, you know, all respect to those people that do, you know, but it made me think. I saw things, and it wasn't all happy. You know, it wasn't happy. I saw, you know, really sad things. I saw people in torment and hell. I saw, like, hideous creatures that would, you know, give little kids nightmares, stuff like that. You know, it's just... And I'm not going to be all, you know, happy like I saw Jesus and the little baby in the cradle and all that, because I didn't see that. I may have saw something that looked like Jesus, but it wasn't happy. It wasn't happy at all. At all. I mean, it kind of scared the hell out of me, you know?
Well, I don't know if it's the exact Urim and Thummim or not, but it's pretty close to it. Well, I looked into it, and I seen what appealed to me as a library. It's like this cave and those holes in the walls or whatever, and had scrolls in it and numbers and writing or whatever on it. But I looked at it about 8 months ago, I would guess.
Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness?
I couldn't see it at first, but after he showed me the little picture of what I've seen, and I looked back in there and I did see it. But I ain't see what, like, I ain't think of nothing that he could use it for. I ain't know what it was.
Do you believe any of that?
Yeah, I believe he's telling the truth.
Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness?
Can I get a witness? I seen blue, like a blue color, and I know I seen God. And he had his hand like this, and I seen a dove. I've seen angel wing.
Oh, Lord, it's Jesus.
Wasn't playing with you, was I?
No, and you told me, I knew you weren't. I believed you a year and a half.
I know you
weren't. A lot of people thought you were crazy, but I knew you weren't. I feel that, I don't know, this is all just come to tell us something. I really don't know what it is, but I feel it's here for a meaning, and everybody needs to know about it, and I've got a good feeling from it, and it's just great.
She's some kind of wonderful. She's
some kind of wonderful.
Yes, she is, she's a,
she's some kind of wonderful.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Seen a treasure chest full of gold, and it looked like a cave. I've seen some angels flying around in there. When Dale first told me about it, I thought he was crazy. Until I looked in it. It's so crazy.
Yeah. Can I get a witness?
Can I get a witness? Up here, I got something to let y'all know here. I need a real person to stand up and be my witness here.
This is the Urim and Thummim, and it's very real. And there's no man can make it, and there's no water or anybody can be able to chip in the details by carving it in or anything like that. And it's the real thing. Money can't even buy this at all.
Sometimes you look at it, it looks like Christ. You know, it looks like Jesus when you look at it.
I'm not sure, but it's just real powerful.
You know, I'm not trying to butter you up or make you believe this Urim and Thummim just for the money, but it's the real Urim and Thummim.
This urn, though, you got it. I mean, that's the thing.
Yeah.
I mean, because it shows everything.
Right.
But once you look into it, and then you'll start to believe in it, and you'll see things that would open up your eyes.
There's people burning. There's, like, torment and like hideous creatures.
Yeah, I believe he's telling the truth.
Just look at it. Look at it for yourself. You'll see. You'll see. I mean, I can't tell you what you're gonna see, and I don't even know if you'll see the same things I saw. But you'll see something.
If people don't believe this, they're gonna be left off the train. You know what I mean?
Look here. Can I please get a witness, y'all? I need somebody on my side.
It's not about the money. Please believe it. We care less about the money. We want to show the Urim and Thummim. Please just give us a chance.
This whole adventure of the Urim and Thummim, we had a great opportunity to go to a university in Nashville, Tennessee called Vanderbilt University. For those of you who are not familiar with it, it's probably the most prestigious university in the South here. Some of the very well-known professors in the university were kind enough to look at the Urim and Thummim and give their honest opinion.
I believe, Arthur, that we're on the verge of a major discovery of a lifetime.
What is it that you think that it is?
It could possibly be the biblical artifact known as the Urim and Thummim.
I'm not familiar with that. What is that?
It was an object in the Bible in the Old Testament that Moses' brother had, Aaron, that he used to communicate to God with. The way that I understand that he used it, he would go into the holiest of holies. He was a high priest. He would go into the holiest of holies. He would pray to God, and he would look into an object called the Urim and Thummim. Some people think it's two stones. They thought it was dice to roll. There's different theories. It's a biblical myth. But he used it to get answers from God.
Well, I can take a look at it. I mean, as you know, I'm in the scientific, skeptical side of things. I'm a professor of archaeology.
It's a crazy story. But then when you begin to look inside, Arthur, only when you're sitting there in your own comfort and you sit there and you look it right down in that material right here, Arthur, you can't even see it and you can't even imagine what I'm going to tell you. But because I know that's a gate, the only reason why I know is because you'll see people's faces that look like they're looking out of them holes like this, Arthur, going like they want to come out. Now, I ain't trying to pull your leg, Arthur. Brother, I wouldn't do that to you for nothing. Heard the words before?
I haven't heard them pronounced exactly the way you're pronouncing them. But Urim and Thummim.
There you go. Yeah, Urim, that's what I'm say it again.
Urim and Thummim.
Urim
and Thummim.
Yeah, that's how the Mormon people, when they came to the house, mentioned it, something like that. Now, is okay. It?
Urim is easy to translate. We're actually in the middle of Hag Urim Sameach. We're actually in the middle of having a happy festival of lights. Urim means lights. So that's easy. Thummim is a more difficult word to translate. The word tam can mean simple or complete. So something about lights and completion, or lights and simplicity. Something
lights
like that.
And perfection. Light and perfection. Uh-huh. That's why I believed I had this specific object. As I was in the Books a Million, so I grabbed the Wycliffe Bible Dictionary, and when I was sitting there flipping through, this word Urim and Thummim kept popping out of some of these Bible books. And I said, well, what is that Urim and Thummim? And when I read what Urim and Thummim meant, it means light and perfection. It told me what I had. Light, perfection. If the light, like if I'm sitting here like this right here, And I'm looking in here right now, and I see this image. When I move that light, doctor, you won't see that image no more.
Mm-hmm. It's important.
So, in other words, light and perfection. If the light isn't just perfect, I'm not going to capture that image again.
Could I see the object one more time?
Yeah. It's like if I take a piece of wood. This is the only way I can explain it. Okay, if I got a light beam shooting this way. If I was an artist, a carver, I'd take a flat piece of wood or stone, and I would carve an image of a person or an animal or anything out. But the way I'm going to carve this thing is going to be from the light beam shining this way, and I'm going to, when every time I make a mark, it's so the light lights that mark up. If I take that same light and I move it to this side, mm-hmm. Guess what? You won't see it. If I take this light and I put it back here and it reflects off the way it was carved again.
Light and perfection. That's what Urim and Thummim means, light and perfection.
You want me to prove it to you how
no,
I know it?
No, I don't want you to prove it. I want you to tell me why it can't just be a holy cup. Why does it have to be the Urim and Thummim?
Because Urim and Thummim means light and perfection.
And I thought it was one of them things that the Catholic priest put incense in, you know, and swing it around like at a funeral, a Catholic funeral, and bless things. That's what I thought it was. But then when I got to reading it more, I found out that it was what the high priest used to carry.
From the description in the Bible, it sounds as though it was a fairly flat object slid into Aaron's breastplate, to his vest. This is a 19th, 20th century, early 20th century artist reproduction, but the breastplate apparently looked something like that, with the different colored stones, or different colors. This is the high priest's breastplate, and then on each stone,
engraved on the stone was the name of a different tribe from the 12 tribes of Israel. And then somewhere in this breastplate, there was a pocket.
And the ephod underneath there.
Exactly. And the
right
ephod,
next to us.
And the ephod means a vest. Ephod is just a Hebrew word for vest.
See, and then I take this thing right here, so I, and I try to put it up against me, just, you know, just to see how it would fit there, you know? Mm-hmm. And it kind of feels so comfortable, like I could almost lay down on it, and it surely wouldn't hurt.
And the way that it fits right there on your chest, if it was kept under the breastplate, it would roll on your chest like that and wouldn't bother you. You know that, dude? If you know how that's made, if it was kept under the breastplate right next to the heart where I know it had to be, look, the way it's shaped, if it was shaped square, dude, it would be, you know, it would hurt you if it got hit on, dude. I could lay on that thing and it wouldn't hurt. Look, it fits perfect like that, and when it fits perfect, man, it won't poke you or nothing, dude. And that's where this was kept, under the breastplate. And it's everything and so much more. I give God the glory.
The Bible mentions Urim and Thummim very infrequently. We know that it was something that Aaron and then later on the high priests had in their breastplate. So modern scholars, in an attempt to reconstruct what the Urim and Thummim were, think about it as some kind of an oracle. If you think about a crazy eight ball, where you ask the crazy eight ball a question, remember the crazy eight balls when we were kids?
Mm-hmm.
You ask a question, and what appears in the light, right? Some kind of an answer. And there would be a limited number of responses. The Urim and Thummim may just have been yes and no questions, but it may also have had a limited repertoire, like not today, but maybe tomorrow. And so the high priests in the Hebrew Bible served as intermediaries between the average person in the Israelite community and God. Mm-hmm. And so when they would go to the high priest with a question, it seems as though the high priest would consult the Urim and Thummim and perhaps throw them on the ground like they were lots or something like that.
I believe he would take it out and set it in a spindle with two holes and lock it in and spin it like that. And then the high priest would look in. This was, of course, after consulting with God. Put it in there, spin it. If he's seen an evil image, I say that's a no answer from God. If he's seen a heavenly image, that would be a yes answer, a positive or negative.
Mm-hmm. Then depending on how the Urim and Thummim fell, that would provide the oracle's answer for whether or not they should marry this woman or go into this
battle.
Business venture or go into this battle, something like that.
But in a dire situation, you know, the Urim and Thummim wasn't used to, you know, foresee if it was going to rain tomorrow, you know, and not being sarcastic, but to be for real, you know, it was used to get answers about the important battles to take place in the holy lands, and what would become of the peoples, you know, in them holy lands.
Question: do you remember to whom the Urim and Thummim was given?
Yes, sir, I do.
Who was it?
I believe it was given to Moses, and then to be handed to Aaron.
Aaron, okay. I'll agree with that. But ultimately, it was Aaron's. It was on his breastplate.
It was within his breastplate.
Within his breastplate.
In a pocket in the ephod next to his heart.
Okay. My question is, do you remember what Aaron had done just a couple of weeks, several weeks before him?
That I don't.
He had built a golden calf. You remember that?
Huh, yeah.
And
yeah.
He said to the people of Israel, Moses is...
That's
has
right.
disappeared up here on Mount Sinai, and now the same guy that led the people astray and many people died because of this golden calf.
Yeah, that
now,
idol.
That's why they needed guidance from God. The Urim and Thummim was God's guidance to make sure that the people would know that Aaron was telling the truth. The people of God need guidance. I think it's fascinating that you're having these visions at a time just like in that day and time when people were doing pretty much what they wanted to do.
There is an ancient text, it goes back about 2,000 years, and it's called the Mishnah. It's the first part of the Talmud. And there is a rabbi called Ben Bagbag, sort of strange name. It's also recorded in Rabbi Akiva's name, a slightly less strange name. And the phrase is, turn it, for everything is in it.
Oh, man.
and generally that was perceived as turn the text, everything is in the text. But there certainly have been mystics that have understood that visually, in terms of turning letters around and perceiving new divine perspectives.
It puts cold chills on me when you tell me that, because that's what this is.
If God blessed me with this object to use as an oracle or to use as a instrument to communicate with him directly, I would certainly do that. I would love to do that, help people like that, if I could.
Have you ever asked God what God wants you to do with this?
Yeah, we're doing it.
I know there's a lot of you out there that's going to say, this guy is off his rocker. But you know what? I'll accept that, and I love you to death, because that's what I expect.
I have enough common sense to know that the story that I'm sitting here telling you is kind of bizarre.
Sure.
So you might have your doubts.
He'll admit to you, he thought maybe I was, you know, maybe just a little bit off maybe at first, but he knows I ain't crazy anyway. Because I've been laughed at in my face, man. I mean, just when I told my wife and my brother, Dale, about it, the first night I was found, they actually thought that they was going to have to take me to the hospital now. And that's only expectable.
I thought Todd was nuts. I really did. I mean, I was like, look, you know, everybody that's going to think you're crazy, you say you found something, everyone's going to look in it, and they're going to think this and that. And
Todd said, I need you to look down in here. Look at this thing, Dale. Look at this thing. And I thought he was totally crazy. I thought he had snapped.
Did you believe me at first?
No, I thought that he has. I thought I was going to have to call him an ambulance because I thought that he went crazy. I thought, you know, ain't no way. There ain't no way.
Many of the prophets historically were considered crazy by their contemporaries. Only later, in later generations, were they acknowledged to be the prophets that they were. Jesus actually says, no prophet is honored in his own land.
I'll be.
You need a little distance, geographical and historical distance, to acknowledge and appreciate prophetic genius and insight.
I'll be. Well, that's awesome. I appreciate that.
The idea that he's crazy and he doesn't have any basis for his visions, his perceptions, his judgment, that's something that is absolutely textbook for religious visionaries.
Could I hear some things about your life before this?
As at a course at a time in my life when I needed a change. But I just asked God to show me for sure that he was real. But I just asked him one night on a Christmas night. On the way home, doctor, I had a screaming match with God Almighty. I said, God, if you're real, you got to show me. I said, send a spirit right here in this seat, on this long, dark road, Lord. Nobody will know.
The only explanation I got maybe why it happened to me is because for maybe some reason that I screamed out to God with such strong belief that night in that car. And I mean, Dr.
Had that been a rough week? Do you remember what happened the week before? You know, psychoanalysts and psychotherapists in general always want to ask, what happened just before? The patient says, I got drunk, or I left my wife, or I told my boss to drop dead. You want to ask, what happened just before then? What made Todd so ready to find an answer of the type he did? Generally, you don't find people going through convictional change like that unless there is crisis. It's a tradition that goes back probably 10,000 years that men and women in crisis are the ones who will naturally look for solutions to their life's troubles, particularly if they feel hopeless. I mean, hopeless means there's nothing in my life now I can see that will make a difference. And that's my reading of Todd's story. As he says, he was at a crossroads. He was in a tremendous amount of pain and suffering. He felt lost. And when you feel lost on this plane, in this horizontal world, where can you go? The species has always found another answer, which is transcendental. If there's nothing in my life between me and
death or suicide or getting drunk again. I can only go into another realm, and that other realm typically is religious. Has this taken you back to church?
We've been escorted out of church with that before.
Really?
I would call churches at my hometown, Owensboro, there, and it's different denominations, the Catholic and the Baptist and the Christian church, okay? Well, the priest wouldn't look at it.
I would call priests at the church on the phone, and they would give me the runaround because they said they didn't have the time, or they had this to do or that to do. Well, that hurt me bad, you know, that a priest wouldn't look at it, and that would be the first person that would want to see it, you know what I'm saying?
Here we are at the Southern Baptist Convention, World Headquarters, Nashville, Tennessee.
Well, I've been denied by many churches to even let me come in the door. I love them all so much, but for them to turn me down is say, hey, I think I might have something that actually could be created by God, and then they either laugh at me or just say, go away. I wish the church here would let me come in and sit down with them and let me explain it a little bit to them. But I've been turned down because they look at me and they judge me because of the way I am.
I call the Owensboro Christian Church the biggest Christian church in Owensboro. And I went there, tried to talk to the preacher. Well, I went in the church, Dale and I did. Needless to say, we got escorted out of the church by security guards.
That's the kind of people I'm dealing with. I've dealt with a lot.
Anyway, to make a long story short,
we are our church.
There's a great book called The Varieties of Religious Experience by William James, published 100 years ago. And William James, one of the great American thinkers, said roughly this: we judge religions by their fruits. The idea there is that we look at people's conversions or their conviction in terms of the effect it has on their lives afterwards. Does it change a human being's capacity to love others, to be ethical, to do the right thing, to stand for values that are transcendent, that are eternal? And if it does, James says, we don't question it. In my talking with the two men, both seem changed. Now, if 30 or 40 or 50 people are changed by them, and they change another 50 each, then you have a small religion. And if it's 100,000 people who are changed, then you have a large religion. It isn't for me to look in that object and find new things. That's not my calling. I'm a professor and a psychoanalyst. But if people see it and look in it and are changed, then that has as much claim to authentic religion as anything else I can think of.
It's changed time in many ways. It has opened up his belief 100% because he wants the world to see this. He wants other people to get the chance to look into this and to see it for what he believes that it truly is. I feel like God does give us signs, and I do feel like there are things that happen in our life that there's a reason behind it, and I believe that this may very well be a sign from God for Todd, you know, and if nothing else, it has totally opened his eyes up in so many ways.
He's changed a lot in the years since he's found it. He used to be pretty wild, and that changed his life a lot.
So I want to know what Chinese people see when they look into the object. I want to know what black people see when they look into the object. And Indian people all across the world, man, we're all in this world together. But if this would bring some sense and peace and calm, but if it would bring us together and show us to love each other as one, man, as brothers and sisters. That's one of my ultimate dreams and hopes and fantasies, man, that this is what it'll do. So the answer's kind of simple for me. Love makes the world go round. And if we stop loving, guess what? The world's gonna stop turning. If we all said, okay, right now, we all wanna make this a better place, all we have to do is forgive each other first of all, and truly forgive each other, and start right now loving each other with the true love.
And I love everybody. I love all of yous, everybody.
But this is like a Rorschach test. Do you know what a Rorschach test is?
I'm from New Orleans, and I only have visions when I have a really, really good 3 or 4 mint juleps.
I don't want to depreciate what Todd is seeing, because I can't see those same visions. I believe in religion. I'm a religious person. And as a religious person, I recognize that there are things in the world that we can't explain rationally. Thank God, I would say to that. I hope that you'll be able to get some closure on this issue without consulting experts. I think that this is something that you are bringing to the object. And as a result of it coming from you, you don't need anybody else's help. So, you know, we're happy to provide whatever help we can on the technical side.
I know.
It seems to me that if this is about you and your relationship to God, that you don't need any other intermediaries.
You're exactly right.
So I wish you the best of luck.
And I appreciate it.
I appreciate your time.
Because it's been a big help.
What I can tell you is what I would do. What I would do is, like, for example, the what it's made of, and is the inside and the outside different? There's a whole variety of techniques, neutron activation, X-ray diffraction, where they can they could take a tiny sample, grind a tiny sample of the material, and then they convert it into a gas, and they bombard it with neutrons. And that tells you the exact chemical composition. And so you could know the chemical composition of the surface and of the inside. And they can do thermoluminescence on this, which might give an approximate age.
Them are expensive tests, aren't they, Arthur? Or?
Well, yeah.
I mean, a person like myself, they
can be.
People have said, hey, let me take it to my laboratory, let me have it tested, let me take it here, and Todd's like, no way, I'm not letting this out of my sight, ever.
This is such a sacred thing, brother, you can't take no scratches off of it, you can't take a sample off of it and all that.
Me and Todd and Dale, we are, you know, like the caretakers of it, you know, it's like, it doesn't belong to us, but we're... like we're to take care of it, you know, and nobody could take it from us. Nobody could. And all the armies, all the nations of the world could join together, and they couldn't take it from us.
My brother guarded it with his life. If someone was to try to snag this Urim and Thummim, or try to harm it, or try to do anything to this, it would not only be the wrath of God touching them, I would lay my life down for this. Todd would lay his life down for it, and I know David's behind us. And with God, me, and David, and Todd, it's untouchable, brother. It's untouchable. Untouchable.
I am the protector of the Urim and Thummim. I will lay down my life at this very moment to protect us from being harmed in any way. Well, you see, I was fixing to pull out of town again to go to Nashville. And I had Urim and Thummim, so anyway, I had it in my trunk of my car, old 65 Ford. And I was coming around the corner down there from my house, me and my brother fixing to pull out to go to Nashville, and this little car got behind me. And apparently I didn't come to a complete stop at the stop sign. And when I seen that it was this detective man, because he put his light up in the dash of his car, I said, oh no. I had a failure to appear warrant on me that time and on another ticket. So I was not too far from the house. And I said to myself, I got to get home. I got the Urim and Thummim in the trunk. I don't care about this car, but I don't want to tow it with this sacred relic in the trunk, you know, and it'll be sitting there in a tow-in lot and anything can happen. I'm not going to leave it. So I said, I'll suffer the consequences from running later. So I took off like a bat out of hell, and I mean, I went all the way home. And on the way to the police station, the police officer had me in the back of the police car, and I told him, I said, you'll never know what I had in the trunk of that car. I said, the reason I ran is because of what I had in the trunk. And he hit that mirror down. I guess he thought I had a dead body or something in there, you know? And I told him, I said, well, I had a discovery in the trunk of my car that there's only one of in the whole world. And I didn't want anything to happen to it. It was in the trunk of the car, and I didn't want the car to get towed off and turned for the Urim and Thummim to be in jeopardy. I won't put that in jeopardy for nothing in the world. Not my life, not nobody's life. The Urim and Thummim is number one to me. But we're back home now. I have to share this with y'all. You know, I have to. I got answers from God through the object. It was a real eerie night, real eerie. It was a cold, cold, cold wind blowing, dark, dark, dark sky. Dale's daddy was in the hospital. So, you know, as crazy as it may be, maybe I overstepped my boundaries with it. And I'm talking into this thing, I say, Lord, in Jesus' name, is Tanita's daddy gonna come out of that hospital? And I seen an image of a man. Instead of just shaking his head no like that right there, his head went out and in like that, like it was protruding out, so I would know for sure he said no. My wife's daddy was laying on that bed dying. And I screamed out to God, because every time I look at my wife, I'd see her crying. And I screamed out, and I love Tiny so much. I screamed out, God, if you're going to let this man live, Lord, if he has to suffer another month, Lord, let him lay there and suffer so you can bring him up out of that bed. But I said, Lord, in Jesus' name, Lord, if you're not going to let this man live and he's going to die anyway, Lord, please take him from his suffering at this moment. Lord, please, in Jesus' name, I ask you. In 10 minutes, the phone rang. Guess what? He died.
I don't think that he should put this down. I think that he should try to get some kind of closure. And if other people are attracted to his vision, then we may have the latest American religious movement on our hands.
Might have a question in your heart that you've been wanting to know from God Almighty. I will consider asking the question if you have a serious spiritual question that you feel will give you some kind of comfort in your life. I would sure be willing to do that for you. I would be more than willing to make this available to you in this way.
So I hop in my truck and I start heading to Owensboro, Kentucky. And it's supposed to be about a 10-hour drive, but that's bullshit because it's every bit of 12 hours. I do it old school style. I'm used to driving from years on the road. I drive straight the whole way. Stop a couple times to piss and get gas and some snacks, but you know, I enjoy the drive. Part of the whole thing for me is getting on the road and just hauling ass. So I roll into town to Owensboro, Kentucky, and it's a very small town situated on the Ohio River. Mr. Walker said that he found this object at a local thrift store.
This right here is what I call the Urim and Thummim.
I'm at the courthouse. This little cute pig here, checking out lots of the town's history. We're very, very close to the location of the Urim and Thummim. We're gonna get, somebody's gonna tell me how to pronounce that pretty soon. I have an address. I might as well go by his house. So I drive over there and I try to find the door, but there's a big long gate that doesn't have a real door, and I start to knock and say hello, hello, and someone from across the street goes, no one's home. And I look around and I said, is this the Walker residence? And he says, who's asking? And I said, hello, you know, and I told him who I was and what I was there for. And he said, oh, you want to see this? And he pulls up his shirt sleeve and shows me a tattoo of the object, which was the cover of the documentary that was done in 2007 on this subject. And he grins like a Cheshire cat and says, come on over here. And it turns out this is Todd Walker's brother-in-law, and they take my phone number and they're all happy and they say, you know, we'll have him call you back. He's out at some flea markets. I love to go to flea markets and antique malls and thrift stores, and since he's there and he supposedly found the object at a thrift store for 69 cents and I see so many around, I decide to go to a peddler's mall. And I walk in a peddler's mall, and a week before I had found in Richmond a Fall Guy lunchbox that didn't have a thermos. So the first thing I do when I go in this giant antique mall is look through some shirts and some records, and out of the corner of my eye, I see a little thermos, and I look down, and it's the Fall Guy thermos. And I don't know how you guys feel about coincidences, but this told me I was on the right path. So he hasn't called back, and it's been a few hours, so I just decide to drive back over there. And I knock on the door, and a man comes out, has no shirt on, big cowboy boots and a cowboy hat, and he's got his hair pulled back in a ponytail, and he's smiling this big smile, and he's the most jovial, friendly man that I could have imagined. And he invites me directly into his little man cave that's out behind his house, and we just start talking. And I don't think he stopped talking the whole time that I was there.
Question ain't really a question when she gets done with you. And the sky is black and still now on the hill where the angel.
You gotta sing that high part.
And it's funny how an old broken bottle looks just like a diamond ring. And it's far, far from me.
Phew.
Todd takes me out to the Ohio River, shows me what he calls God's country.
This is you and God. And that's what it is. And I love it.
For him, that's the kind of things that wakes me up, I guess I'm trying to get at.
Now, the story of this object is that he found it at a Goodwill 20 years ago in Nashville. And he's telling me all these stories. And he must have been shot at or someone attempted to kill him like 5 or 6 times.
I dip sit down on the floor. I got that. Because I seen Mike slinging that damn shotgun around, and she was, I guess she was on the dance floor. I didn't really see her.
And anyway, he chased her outside, her and Jason chased her outside, and you heard a big boom and a pow, 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 pow. And God dang it, they went out there and fucked it. Here come Mike. She got him right here in his arm, and he couldn't chord his guitar no more. It was either that or he just too scared to be around her because she was a wild bitch.
And I'm thinking, this man might be more incredible than this object.
Yeah, because you got to say the right thing sometime, you know, and you got to know what you're talking about. And, you know, I ain't the fucking smartest bird in the nest, you know what I'm saying?
We go back to his house, roll a joint, and he takes out a little bag. And inside of the bag is a little hat that looks like James J. Walker's hat. And he pulls out this marble object that looks like a lamp, except for it has holes on the side. He takes out a little series of red lights, and we manipulate the light on it, and we look at it. And he had told us that he doesn't look into it anymore. I think that he had tried to put it away. And nobody came to talk to him in 12 years since they had made this movie. I might be the only person who came to interview him about it. And I find out that he's spent all this money. He flew himself out to talk to that guy from Ancient Aliens, Giorgio Chavaclius, or whatever that guy's name is, and saved up his money, and he beat himself up in a hotel room for 3 days because he handed that guy a DVD with his phone number on it, and he expected him to call him. And he's just tortured himself with this object.
You scientists and geologists, archaeologists, come to me. Get on the site. Ask me questions.
I decided to go to talk to a rabbi.
First of all, what was the Urim and Thummim in the Torah, in the original Hebrew text?
So the Urim and Thummim are shrouded in mystery, but we have a clear description of it in Exodus 27. Inside the breastplate of decision, you shall place the Urim and Thummim. And the way it was used is that Aaron, the high priest, wore a breastplate that looked something like this, and it was worn around his neck. There was 12 different gemstones, each for the 12 tribes of Israel, in a bag like this.
He had a bag that looked like a crown royal bag, except it was black instead of purple, and it had these two rocks. One was black and one was white.
Identical in nature, except that one would be light and one would be dark. And so they were placed in the bag or the pocket, which was behind the breastplate. And when there was a decision to ask for the high priest that had no earthly answer, you would ask him a question, he would reach in and without looking, pull out an answer. And if it was white, the answer would be no or guilty. And if it was dark, then the answer would be yes or innocence.
This bag of rocks, it was like a Price is Right game.
More than 100, hundreds of people have observed this, and they will tell you that they see images inside of it and on the outside of this object.
I think regardless of if you believe this relic that he has in his hand is handed down from the hand of God, it's profoundly changed him in a way that's positive, because he sounded like an outlaw. I still feel like the story is incredible and human and about all of us searching for answers in something, whether it's on the road or in an object or in a person or in a belief system. We're all looking for answers.
I'm gonna play you one right here. We'll all be drinking that free bubble up and eating that rainbow stew.
I don't know you, but I still care about you. I care about the whole world, ladies and gentlemen. If we don't get this world back to turning the way it's supposed to, we're going to all lose together in the end.
If somebody cuts my leg off, I'm going to be pretty pissed about it.
Well, I might hop over to him and knock the jaw loose, but I can still love him and do that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I told my wife that, babe, I might have to take this back to Israel.